So first, thanks to the organizers of this thematic program and of this nice workshop. So what I will present is joint work with Ottobal team, who moved from Jena to Vienna and to Frankfurt, and now he's in Prague. And Thomas Wannerer, who moved from Jena to Frankfurt and to Jena. Vienna. And there are some preprint that you can find on archive from late 2023. And so let me first start with Alexandra Penzel in Ecology.
Andreas, the chalk is
hanging.
So, Alexandra Penzel inequality is a famous inequality in Prominkowski's theory. So, in Prominkowski's theory, you try to understand the interplay between the volume of Rn and the Minkowski sum. And we have seen the Prominkowski inequality several times. And so K and L are compact convex bodies inside Rn, and here you need this power 1 over n, because the volume is n homogeneous, as was explained, for instance, in Andrea Colisanti's talk or in Rotem Suhlin's talk. And the fact that the volume is n homogeneous, one can use to prove that it can be polarized, so there's a mixed volume. That takes n compact convex bodies and associates to them some a priori field number, and it is Minkowski linear in each component and symmetric with respect to these entries. And if all entries are the same, then you just obtain the usual volume. So that's the mixed volume, and the famous Alexandra Penzel inequality says that whenever you have two compact convex bodies K and L, and then some reference bodies C1 to Cn minus 2, then this thing here is larger than square. Okay, so that's the famous Alexandra Penzel inequality, and I am aware of three rather different proofs, one coming from algebraic geometry that will not play such a role here, and then two proofs that are both due to Alexandrov, and both will play some role in my talk, and so let me just give you some ideas in these two proofs. And in the first proof, two proofs, in the first proof, we reduce to some finite dimensional case. Some finite dimensional case. Namely, we start with a simple polytope. And look at the vector space generated by the summands of P. Summands of P. And then one is doing something with this. I don't want to go too much into details, but that's somehow the setting. So it's some finite dimensional thing, because P has only finitely many summands. And in the second proof, one uses some elliptic operator. On functions on the units here, and so that's these are the two different settings. But then there are some similarities in the two proofs. Namely, in both cases, one can prove that Alexandra Fenster inequality is equivalent to some statement about some kind of matrix. In the first case, Alexandra Fenster inequality is equivalent to saying that some matrix has precisely one strictly positive eigenvalue. Some symmetric matrix. And in the second case, well, an elliptic operator also has eigenvalues, and the Alexandra Fenster inequality says that the elliptic operator has precisely one strictly positive eigenvalue. Okay, so in both cases, that's not too difficult to prove that Alexandra Fenster inequality is equivalent to these statements. And then in both cases, the proof of these statements then uses the so-called homotopy method. And so the homotopy method, homotopy argument, reduces the problem to some known situation. Where the reference bodies C1 to Cn minus 2 are either the polytope P itself or the unit book, the Euclidean unit book. So in the first case, we reduce it to P, and in the second case, to the unit book. And somehow, in both cases, we are doing this. And then we use, in the first case, we use the fact that the eigenvalues of a matrix, they depend continuously on the entries of this matrix. And so to prove that there is strictly one positive eigenvalue, we just have to make sure that no negative eigenvalue becomes positive and no positive eigenvalue becomes negative, and this one can prove. And the same thing here, the eigenvalues of an elliptic operator depend continuously on this operator, and then again one has to make sure that the sign of an eigenvalue cannot change during this process. And then one arrives at such a situation where the reference bodies are all equal and simple, and in this case then this inequality is basically followed from Bunyakovsky inequality. So that's the sketch of proof or proof of Alexandra Fenster inequality. And there is some more general statement due to McMull. These are so-called quadratic inequalities. They state the following, so now I have to read because there are some assumptions and it's not quite that simple as the Alexandra Fenster inequality. So we fix some number k between 0 and n half, and then some nij, some reference bodies, and they all should be strongly isomorphic to a fixed simple polytope, which means basically that when you have a simple polytope, you can move the faces in parallel direction, and then you obtain these elements here. And now we make some assumption. If the sum from I to some capital N, xi mixed volume of a non-i to a ki, then some bodies p0 to cn minus 2k. And now I put some dot here. So the mixed volume you can plug in n bodies or n polytopes, and here we only have k plus n minus 2k plus 1, so we can plug in something still here. And actually k minus 1 things can be plugged in here. And we want that whatever we plug in there, we obtain 0. So that's our assumption.
For all x. What is xi?
Xi are real numbers.
So for all xi?
No. No, you have some equation of this type. Some equation of this type where xi and the a's and the c's are fixed. If this is the case, then minus 1 to the k times some xi xj mixed volume of a1i aki a1j kj, c1 to cn minus 2k is non-negative. And equality if and only if the sum of xi mixed volume a1i ki. And now I just put a dot here, is 0. Okay, so this seems a bit hard to digest. So let's first look at two particular cases. The first case is what happens if k equals 0. But that's somehow a kind of degenerate case, because as I said, here you can plug in k minus 1 things, so if k equals 0, doesn't mean to plug in minus one things, but in this case we just forget about this assumption. So in the case k equals 0, what we will obtain is that something is non-negative, and actually the case k equals 0 just means that mixed volumes are positive. Which is true, but it's not completely obvious. Right, so even the case k equals 0 of the statement says something which is interesting. Now the case k equals 1, this implies Alexandra-Fentel inequality. And to see this, one has to write such an equation of this type. And so I'm not sure that I would get it right, but you start somehow with K and L and some reference bodies in minus 2, and then you would, in this case, here you can plug in nothing, so these are just real numbers, and so I just want to find some linear relation between some mixed volumes, and I think something of this type, you take maybe two K's here. And whether there exists some lambda, some lambda of this type, and then you use this inequality here, and you reformulate, and then you will get Alexandra-Fentel. Okay, and so since the case k equals 1 is the usual Alexandra-Fentel inequality, the case where k is larger than 1 can be considered as some kind of higher order Alexandra-Fentel inequalities. And so kind of generalizations, and therefore interesting. Now one may wonder if in the case k larger than 1, this statement is non-trivial. I mean, since this was shown by McMullen, one would expect that it's not non-trivial. And so somehow the question that arises is, are there examples where this thing here holds? Because if k is larger than 1, then we can plug in here other polytopes. And so can we write down such equations? That's not completely obvious. But since we are in a finite dimensional situation, what we can plug in here, you only have finitely many possibilities. So actually this thing here is not one equation, but finitely many equations. But we also can make the number of summands here very large. And so if we take n very, very large compared to the number of things that we can plug in here, then it seems obvious that there are some combinations that will give zero. Yeah? So
now this condition is supposed to hold for anything that you plug in? Or?
For any thing that is a summand of this given simple polytope. So we are in this finite dimensional situation. Okay, so that's McMullen's theorem, and now the main theorem of my work is Kotobati and Wanderer from 23. Says that the same statement holds true. Same statement holds true in another setting, namely in the setting of smooth convex bodies with positive curvature. So by this I mean now the A's and the C's are smooth compact convex bodies with positive curvature. You have an equation of this type where here you can now plug in an arbitrary compact convex body, say with smooth one with positive curvature, and then you will obtain this inequality here. And the particular cases are as before, so k equals 0 then just implies that mixed volumes are positive, k equals 1 implies the Alexandre-Fenchel inequality for such bodies. And something that I should mention here is namely that if we have the Alexandre-Fenchel inequality here or in this case, first of all we have it in this case of simple polytopes, and here we will have it in the case of smooth bodies with positive curvature. But since the general Alexandre-Fenchel inequality of course follows just by approximation, so you can approximate a convex body by a sequence of polytopes or by a sequence of smooth convex bodies, so this is just by approximation. And in this case, for this theorem, it becomes, how to say this correctly, it becomes less trivial to see that it's non-trivial. Does it make sense to say this? So, to say that it's non-trivial means that we have to make sure that there are such equations here. But now, since we can plug in here any compact convex body, with smooth one positive curvature, well, there are infinitely many such bodies that we can plug in here, and so we have infinitely many equations. So it's not clear why there are such things, but it comes out somehow of the proof that that there are many such equations. So there are many situations where we can apply this theorem. Okay, before giving a proof, let me give you a counterexample. Which is due to Fernando. Okay, so we take n equals 4, k equals 2, and we take k to be the unit ball, and L we take L we take a so-called cat body, which is the convex hull of the unit ball and some point outside the unit ball. Right? So that's a four-dimensional situation, but my picture is three-dimensional. And then one has the following equation. So it's an equation of this type. So 3 times mixed volume of BBL something plus mixed volume of LFL something minus mixed volume of E plus L something is zero. So this equality comes from the fact that this cat body appears in some equality cases in Alexandrov-Fenchel inequality. Right? So the question what are precisely the equality cases is open. There is some progress due to Schoenfeld and Van Andel in the polytope case, and in the in the smooth case there are basically no non-trivial equality cases. But here, well, there are some interesting equality cases related to such cap bodies. So one gets this this equation. And in this case, if we now write down this quadratic term here, I don't want to write it down, but if you write it down, well, what should come out if k equals 2 is that something is it's positive, but in this case, we will obtain that the quadratic term related to this equation is strictly negative. So, what does it mean? Well, it's not really a counterexample, of course, to the theorem, because in the theorem we assume that our bodies are smooth convex bodies with positive curvature. This thing here is not smooth and it has not positive curvature, so we are sure twice that it does not apply.
In the original second equality, what could the variable be?
This thing here?
Yes.
Any summand of the given simple polytope.
So this should be true for any simple polytope in place of the dot?
No.
No. So the simple polytope is fixed. And then you look at all summands of P. And here you can, these are summands of P, and you can plug in a summand of P.
So which one is the problem, the non-smoothness or the zero
problem? I cannot really answer this because in our approach we really need both.
Mm-hmm. If you put a little smooth in the tip of the cone, does it? Is it still negative?
It's hard to say because then you will violate also this this equality here.
Okay. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Okay. It turns out that these quadratic inequalities due to McMullen they can be put into some more abstract setting, namely that of so-called Taylor package. Taylor package? Well, there are maybe some different degrees of generality, but I will take a definition coming from some expository paper of Jun Ha, who used many different versions of Taylor package to prove famous conjectures in combinatorics. And in this setting, A is a finite dimensional graded vector space. So So very often it will be some algebra, but in this version it's first a graded vector space, and it comes with some pairing. It takes two elements and gives us a real number, and this should be a symmetric bilinear map. And the letter P stands for Poincaré duality, because in many examples it will really correspond to some Poincaré duality. And C will be some cone of linear maps that are of degree 1, so they increase the degree by plus 1. And very often one has the following set of statements. The first statement is Poincaré duality, which says that if you apply this thing P here to some Q-homogeneous part and D minus Q-homogeneous part, then what you will obtain that this is a non-degenerate pairing.
So the A sub Q is the same as the A Q, or?
Here there's a Q.
Okay.
So Poincaré duality says that this pairing is non-degenerate, then the so-called Hart-Lefschetz property says that whenever you take different of these maps, so you take a certain number of these maps, then you can produce a map from AQ to AD minus Q just by taking eta to value, just apply these maps to and the thing is that Hart-Lefschetz says that this is a bijection. And then there's a third property that is satisfied very often. These are the so-called Bertschumann relations. In this case, we take one more of these maps. And now we look at the pairing from AQ from some quadratic form on AQ. Namely, we take two elements, eta 1 and eta 2, and map them to minus 1 to the Q times P of eta 1. And now we just apply almost all of these maps to second one. This is positive definite. So this is a quadratic form and it is positive definite. But not on the space on all of AQ, but only on some subspace, namely on the kernel of the following map. We go from AQ to AP minus Q plus 1, and this time we use all the maps, so L0 to LD minus 2 QK. And this kernel is called the primitive subspace, and on this primitive subspace, this quadratic form should be positive definite. Okay, so whenever we have such a situation with all these statements satisfied, then we say that we have a Kähler package. Now, let me give you some examples. Well, the first example is McMahon's algebra. Of a simple polytope. So So if you have a simple polytope, you can look at vector space generated by the summands, and then you can endow this with some algebra structure. And then McMullen has shown that this algebra satisfies all these conditions here. And I'm not quite sure, but I think his main interest was in this Hart-Lefschetz property, because he wanted to prove the, he wanted to give a new proof of the so-called G conjecture. And the G conjecture says something about the possible number of k-dimensional faces of a simple polytope. And if you rewrite this in some ways, then you will see that you obtain some sequence that is strictly increasing until the middle, and then strictly decreasing and symmetric. And this is precisely what you get out of this Hart-Lefschetz theorem here. So this was his motivation, and but he needed also the Hodge-Riemann relations because the whole proof used some inductive scheme. And so this thing here was needed in the induction. Okay, so that's one example, but there are many other examples, namely the cohomology of a compact Taylor manifold, also satisfies such a package, and this is where somehow the name comes from, right? So there's this Hart-Lefschetz theorem in Taylor geometry, and okay, Poincaré duality, of course, is related to cohomology, and the Hodge-Riemann relations are also something in Taylor geometry. But I must say that even in this case, the whole package here, where you can have here some cone of linear maps, this is rather recent thing. So it's due to Din and Nguyen from 2009 or 2010 or around this. So it's not something completely classical even in this case. Now there are some new things. So called tau ring of a Markovitz, which is some combinatorial object, also satisfies these things. And so this is work due to Jun Ha and Karim Adipasito with many applications in combinatorics. But I don't want to go into detail about this. There's two other examples, so called combinatorial intersection theory. And the last one, algebraic, let me just say, Grothendieck standard conjecture. Which are some famous conjectures in algebraic geometry, and they say that whenever you have some varieties, then you find such a Taylor package. But this one is open. It's just the first four are statements, and the last one is a conjecture. Okay, so there are examples of such Taylor packages. Okay. Now, I succeeded in giving a talk without mentioning the word valuation for half an hour, so it's quite achievement, but now I can no longer avoid it. So, yeah, so in this first case, this McMullen algebra of a simple polytope. These quadratic inequalities, they really look like this thing here, and actually one can see that if one proves this such a Taylor package for the McMullen algebras, and really one obtains his quadratic inequalities. The Hart-Lefschetz theorem is actually just a consequence of the Hodge-Riemann relations in this case. So one can see with some work that this map is injective, is a consequence of this thing here positive, this thing here being positive defined. And since we are in a finite dimensional situation and we have this Poincaré duality, then well, these spaces here, or these spaces here, they are of the same dimension, so it's enough to prove that the corresponding map is injective. So that's this situation. But now we want to apply, we want to prove these quadratic inequalities in the setting of smooth convex bodies with positive curvature. And so the question is, what is now the corresponding Taylor package? So our Taylor package. Well, in our situation, we will look at valuations. So while will be the space of continuous and translation invariant valuations. So valuation is something that takes compact convex bodies and associates real numbers and satisfies this property that mu of k plus L plus mu of k intersect L is mu of k plus mu of L whenever it makes sense. So we have seen this notion in, for instance, Monika Ludwig's talk and Jonas Knörr's talk, and also Dima Schreffmann's talk. And translation invariant is clear, so if we translate the convex bodies, then the value should not change, and continuity is with respect to the Hausdorff topology on compact convex sets. And an example of such a valuation is the map that takes k and maps it to some mixed volume. I here n minus I fixed convex bodies, then this is a valuation. This thing here is a valuation. Okay, but that's not completely the space underlying our Taylor package. We need a slightly slightly stronger assumption. Namely, we look at the space of so-called smooth valuations. They appeared at least in Dimitri Feifmann's talk. And in this case, so this is the space of smooth valuations is the vector space generated by valuations of this type. Evaluations of this type with the C1s, the reference bodies, they should now be smooth with positive curvature. That's not the definition that Dimitri Feifmann gave in his talk. And actually, to see that this thing here is equivalent to some now more classical definitions of smoothness of valuations is a recent result, which is due to Jonas Knörr and just an independent proof due to von Handel. And so they prove that somewhat the usual definition of smoothness implies this thing here and vice versa. So we can use now this as definition if you want. Now, the claim is that this will be our Taylor package. This does not quite work because already, already the first condition here fails because this is not a finite dimensional space. So you have We have, of course, many such valuations. But okay, so let's forget about finite dimensionality for the moment. Now we need some grading. Well, the grading is some very known statement, which is so-called McMullen decomposition. So this was also mentioned in some previous talk. So one can decompose valuations by degree of homogeneity. And then we need some cone of such linear maps. And they come actually this thing here is an algebra. So we can multiply two such things. And this is the so-called convolution product. Which I introduced with Chofu in 2006. And so a short way to write it is to say that if we have the valuation volume of k goes to volume of k plus c1, and we take the convolution with volume of something plus c2, and this is the volume of something plus c1 plus c2. And then one can prove that by linearity it extends to all linear combinations of such things, so to all smooth valuations. So we have a product, and our Lefschetz maps, so these maps here, this will be just the convolution with some mixed volume. Maybe I will not write it down completely here. But let me state somehow the theorem. So this scalar package looks in the following way. So that's somehow equivalent to, but a bit more precise to the theorem that I stated at the beginning. So we take the following map from n minus k to k homogeneous valuations. We take some valuation from smooth valuation phi and map it to phi convoluted with some mixed volume. This map is an isomorphism. But now these spaces are usually infinite dimensional. And so being an isomorphism is maybe not, not exactly what we want, but it's an isomorphism of topological vector spaces. And the second part. And the second part, we define some quadratic form. Namely, we take minus 1 to the k times phi convolution with phi times lc phi, so this thing here I want to phi. This quadratic form is positive defined. On the space of so-called primitive valuations, namely on the kernel of LC0, so in this case we need one more of these reference bodies, so on the kernel of this, which goes from a subspace in Wald in minus k. Okay, so this is a more precise version. And the first statement is again called Hart-Lefschetz theorem, and this thing here are the Riemann relations. And so Riemann relations, they imply, as in McMullen's work, the quadratic inequalities that I was mentioning. Some cases of this theorem were known before, namely for the Hart-Lefschetz theorem, if all the reference bodies C1 to Cn minus 2k are Euclidean unit balls, then the statement was shown by me and Ludwig Bröcker in 2007. This operation, by the way, also appeared in Leo Braunau's talk. So he had two operations on Minkowski evaluations, and one is precisely this, where all the reference bodies are unit bodies. The Hodge-Riemann relations in the same case, where all the reference bodies, so all these C's and also C0 is the unit ball, say were shown by Kotobadi-Wannerer, also in 2023, using methods from harmonic analysis. So they were using highest weight vectors corresponding to irreducible representations of SON and computed some multipliers, and then the multipliers were positive, and they could show this positive definiteness. So these are the known cases. And I want to make some remark on this thing here. So this is not a finite dimensional setting. In this infinite dimensional setting, it is not true that the injectivity of this map implies the surjectivity. So the surjectivity here is something that is complicated to prove. Injectivity of this map still follows from the Hodge-Riemann relations, but in contrast to the case of McMullen's polytope algebra, there is no way of giving some inductive proof. We really, McMullen proved this, and then he applied it to this in the case of the McMullen polytope algebra, but this we cannot do. So we first have to prove the Hart-Lefschetz theorem, and using the Hart-Lefschetz theorem, we then prove the Hodge-Riemann relations. And I just want to say a few words about ideas that go into that. In the last 2 minutes or 3 minutes that I have. So first for the Hart-Lefschetz theorem, so injectivity part is somehow a standard proof. So it uses Stokes' theorem and some linear version of the Hodge-Riemann relations, but it is somehow in the case of compact Kähler manifolds, this is precisely how injectivity also works. Shown, so it's standard. Nevertheless, it took us a long time to understand this case already, but afterwards we realized that it's not so difficult. Now, surjectivity in the Hart-Lefschetz theorem. Well, surjectivity is we want to find some object that is mapped to some other object. Right? This is surjectivity. And we are doing it in the way somebody from PDEs would do this. Namely, first of all, we construct some more general object. So in the case of if you want to solve PDEs, then you would first try to find some generalized solution. Right. So first find some generalized solution. So generalized solution using Hahn-Banach. And then use elliptic regularity to prove smoothness. Okay, so written like this, this seems quite straightforward, quite standard, but it's not clear at all what this all means in this setting. So first of all, there's no elliptic operator, so I don't know what an elliptic operator on valuations would be. And in particular, this convolution operator is not something like a differential operator. This seems a bit strange. To apply Hahn-Banach, we also need some more structure like a Hilbert space. Valuations, they do not form a Hilbert space. So this general scheme, I mean, it looks very easy, but to make this work requires a lot of time. Okay, but then we proved this. And then the Riemann relations, we want to use the homotopy method. So this homotopy method was used in the way that the reference bodies were changed, and then something the continuity of the eigenvalues of something was used. Now here the problem is that if k is larger than 1, then if we use this quadratic form and we write down the eigenvalues, then we expect that there are infinitely many positive ones and infinitely many negative ones. So and then, I mean, what does it then mean to that some quadratic form is positive somewhere? So then it becomes a bit a mess. So one has to first do some tricks to reduce this to a situation where one has to prove that some quadratic form is positive. And to make this homotopy method work, we have to leave the setting of Alexandrov. So we have to leave the world of elliptic operators, and we have to use unbounded linear operators, so some concept from functional analysis, and then use perturbation theory, namely the theorem due to Kato and Relish, which says that when you have a small perturbation of some self-adjoint positive operators, then it stays self-adjoint and positive. And then the homotopy method works and gives us the full proof. Okay, thank you very much.